Welcome friends, welcome to EPG Patashala. I am Dr. Janardhan, working as additional professor in the Department of Psychiatric Social Work from NIMHANS. Today we are going to learn about clinical assessment and diagnosis. How do we make clinical assessment and diagnosis for person with mental illness? It's very crucial for treating psychiatric problem. If you have to understand any psychiatric illness, we need to do an assessment. The assessment need to be clear so that it will be able to understand the person's behavior and then provide intervention for this person with mental illness. So assessment help the clinician to connect and to gather important data from the person with mental illness and also from the caregivers. This is the single most important method of arriving at an understanding of a person with mental illness who exhibit the signs and symptoms of psychiatric illness. And it requires a considerable preparation and practice for a clinician or for any mental health professionals who have been working. So unless they have been well oriented towards the assessment, they may not be able to understand a person with mental illness and then help the person with mental illness and the family. The task for the therapist to conduct a clinical assessment is to establish rapport and set goal for assessment. So if the rapport is not been established, then the person will may not be able to understand the symptoms. Rapport should be established with person with mental illness and also with the caregivers. If the clinician failed to build rapport with the person with mental illness and only build rapport with the caregiver, the person would feel neglected and he may not cooperate for conducting mental status examination, and it is going to affect the assessment and then come to a conclusion or to give a diagnosis for a person with mental illness. Need to develop a collaborative clinician-patient relationship. If this is not been there, then we may not be able to have a diagnosis for a person with mental illness. So therapists need to communicate empathetically, maintain appropriate boundaries, need to communicate in a language that the patient understand, and avoid psychiatric jargons. Particularly when we are writing the presenting complaints, we should not give our interpretation. It should be written down as communicated by the patient or by the family member. So monitor the emotional intensity of the interview and adjust as necessary when required. Gather pertinent psychiatric history, perform mental status examination, assess whether patient is reliable and safety. Develop a plan for possible emergencies, particularly when you are seeing a person who is violent. So as a therapist or as a mental health professional, should be careful and also need to make arrangement for his safety. Like, doors should be kept open when we are assessing a person with mental illness. When the person started showing the anger outburst, need to withdraw from the person rather than just continuing the interview. Need to take a break, and then always we can come back and do the assessment at later phase. So we need to know when the person is going to get angry and also make necessary safety measures in order to protect ourselves. Review previous records and other available data which the patient carry. Most of the time they would have shop doctors, so collect all the relevant information and see how this can be helpful in terms of treating the person. Usually when they go to different doctors would have tried out with the different type of medicine, different type of antipsychotics. So we need to know whether it has been adequately dosage been given for adequate period of time. If it is given, then it will help the psychiatrist in terms of deciding on the treatment and deciding on the medication what to be given. Interview others as appropriate. Here others means the caregivers would be there or a relative would be accompanying the person. So find out how much information we would require from that person, collect that much. If not required, so we can always tell the relative to be seated outside. Whenever required, we can take that person's help. Document accurately whatever the information would require for the assessment need to be documented accurately, and also we need to manage time. It's not necessary that we need to do an assessment for hours together. With 45 minutes to 1 hour, it's possible to do an assessment and come to a conclusion and later it can be clarified whatever doubts we have, which will help us in terms of understanding a person's behavior. In clinical assessment, we have these are the main areas we are going to look at it, where we are going to collect history about the person's mental health condition, then perform mental status examination of that person, then do a physical examination, come out with a formulation, then plan for investigation and give a diagnosis, make a treatment plan and then do a follow-up. So these are the various areas we need to concentrate when we are doing a clinical assessment. Coming back to history taking, so our history taking starts with sociotomographic detail. We look at the age of the person, how much he is educated, whether employed, married, from which type of socioeconomic status, is it upper middle socioeconomic status or lower middle, lower socioeconomic status. If you have any documentary proof in terms of whether the family is under BPL category or non-BPL category. So all this information would be collected under sociotomographic details. With regard to the informant source, we need to comment upon whether the information is reliable, adequate, and the relationship of the informant with the patient. In case if a father or mother is accompanied, the relationship need to be mentioned. In case if it is a far relative who would have just accompanied the person during the acute episode, that also need to be mentioned. So which will all will help us to understand whether the information provided by the caregiver is reliable or not reliable, whether the information is adequate or not adequate. If it is not adequate, then we need to look in terms of other sources of getting information so that we will be able to person with mental illness. We are going to look at its complaint and their duration in a chronological order we need to mention. As I earlier said, the complaints need to be written down in the language what been specified by the person or the caregiver who had accompanied. Like in case if they say that this person has been talking to self, it has to be written as talking to self, even though the interpretation would be the person is responding to the voices where it can be hearing voices. So whatever the complaints they would give us, that need to be written rather than giving our interpretation in the complaint thing. Then history of present illness, we need to start with the onset and precipitating factors, course of illness and associated disturbances. Sometimes the onset may be acute onset, where usually acute onset is associated with the stress which would have happened 10 days or 15 days a month ago, the stress would have been there. Now the current episode would have been there. In the acute phase, it is till few days back person was okay, suddenly the person started behaving abnormally, where we need to mention whether it is an acute onset or is an insidious onset. Insidious means over a period of time this person started behaving abnormally. We need to look in terms of was there any precipitating factor before to the illness, and the course of illness, is it how long this illness was there and how the symptoms have been progressing over a period of time, and any other disturbances associated with that need to be given. Once the history of present illness has been completed, we need to look at the family history, where we look at the genogram, we'll write a genogram of their family, where the family history is also collected in terms of whether in that family any person with mental illness been there in that family, and make a brief understanding about the family dynamics in terms of the power structure in that family. Then under personal history, we start collecting information from birth and early development. Mostly the caregivers would be able to give this such information. If the caregiver is not able to give such information, we would say the information could not be collected and the attempt will be made at the later phase. So the birth and early development history we need to collect from the details of prenatal, natal and postnatal periods and physical illnesses during postnatal period, milestones of development. And this is very important if you have to make a diagnosis of that person is having an intellectual disability, because a person with intellectual disability would have delay in milestone developments and have complication during the time of delivery, or history about prenatal is very important in order to understand this person's condition. So we need to have information about all this category, all these headings under birth and early development. The next group is behavior during childhood, where we are going to look in terms of how the child was behaving the child was showing a lot of temper tantrums, nail biting, bed wetting, stammering, which would have its effect on the later life. So we need to know how the behavior of the childhood during that period. And then we are going to look at the physical illnesses during childhood, whether the child had epilepsy, meningitis, encephalitis or any other illnesses, which can also act as a contributing factor towards mental illness. We need to collect information about the schooling, so age of beginning and then finishing school, the type of school attended, whether the child was comfortable in the school, whether the child had difficulties in the school, how he was maintaining relationship with his friends, how he was maintaining relationship with the teacher, whether there were many complaints against this child. So all this information is required, so which would help us in understanding if in case if this child is having problems at the school, not able to sit at one place and always troubling other children. It will give some information, like it will help us in understanding the child was hyperactive at the school phase, which also would have impacted at the later phase of his life. Then we need to look at the occupation. So age of starting working and jobs held in chronological order, why the person has been shifting job from one place to another, any reasons, if it is just economic or remunerative reason, that also need to be noted down, or is it because of stress, unable to manage his friends and then shifted the school, which gives an important information about his personality, which will help us in understanding and then coming out with a diagnosis. Menstrual history is another important area where we need to collect information. It should be like age of information should be from the age of menarche, reaction to menarche, whether the periods were regular and emotional disturbances in relation to menstrual cycle. So all those things need to be collected. Sexual history. So age at onset of puberty, level of knowledge regarding sex, mode of gaining knowledge, masturbatory practices, anxiety related to sexual fantasies, practices, homosexual, heterosexual orientation, fantasies and experiences, extramarital relationship, all this history need to be collected. And then under marital history, we need to look at age at marriage, age at the time of marriage, whether it was an arranged marriage or a choice marriage, was it mutually consented, and education, occupation, health and personality of partner, quality of marital relationship, separation or divorce, number of children, their ages and their healthy status, the marital interaction, the interaction between the couple, all this need to be collected as part of marital history. This will help us in understanding whether the person is having a happy marriage or having difficulties in the marriage, and how these problems would have contributed towards the mental illness we'll be able to understand. Then the next category is substance use, where we look in terms of whether this person has been exposed or been using alcohol, tobacco and drugs, and how long this person has been using alcohol or smoking, and any effects in terms of his health, or whether this person is having any withdrawal related symptoms. Those need to be assessed under this category. The next item of assessment would be pre-morbid personalities, where we look at social relationship, intellectual activities and mood, where we look in terms of the person's interaction with his friends, groups and society, whether he had more number of friends and how he used to adjust with the friends, we would look at it. If the person is having no friends or little friends, which would give us an information about the personality of this person who is sitting in front of us. So it's intellectual activities like hobbies, interests, whether the person was able to get into any hobbies place, or preferred memory, observation, judgment, critical faculty, how he was using, all this need to be collected, which will help us in making a plan for him to go back to pre-morbid level of personality, whatever this person was able to do. Need to understand the mood, whether he was a very moody person, small things would trouble this person, or he used to cheer up and come back and enjoy the life, or always would be preoccupied with the stresses, and which would affect his mood. That need to be understood. They need to look at the character, energy and initiative, whether the person was energetic, and then understand the fantasy life, frequency and the content of daydreaming, and then habits, what type of habit this person was having. So all this information would help us in understanding the person, and it will be able to differentiate between this pre-morbid personality and the current problems, how it is different, which would help us in diagnosis. If the pre-morbid personality itself is a person like who is an introvert person, and suddenly if the person become an extrovert, starting over-socializing with everyone, so that means there has been a definite change from his pre-morbid personality, which would help us in understanding and giving a diagnosis for this person with mental illness. The next category is the mental status examination. So it's a long process. So usually we need to get training in order to do a mental status examination. It cannot be done by everyone. Unless we are trying to do a mental status examination, it's difficult for us to come out with interpretation, and based on these interpretations, we'll be able to provide a diagnosis for a person with mental illness. So I would suggest that everyone cannot do an MSc. Unless you have a specific training to do an MSc, you should not make an attempt to do an MSc here. So general appearance and behavior. So we would start our MSc recording about the general appearance and behavior, where we are going to look whether the person was conscious, whether adequate eye to eye contact was maintained, whether oriented, and presence of any tics or mannerism, any catatonic phenomena was present or not. We are going to make a comment on that. We are also going to make a comment on the self-care, the observation with regard to his personal hygiene, how he maintained himself in the room, whether rapport could be established, not established. So all those information need to be recorded and interpreted during the general appearance and behavior. Then we are going to look at the psychomotor activity, whether increased, decreased or normal. Normally in a person with a manic episode, the psychomotor activity will be increased, where the person will be talking at the same time, having lot of hand movements, not able to sit at one place, often getting up from a seat and then talking. So we should indicate that this person is having extra energy and the psychomotor activity has increased. If the person with a depression, usually it will be decreased, where there will be no movement of the physical movement, and the talking also will be less. Then we have next category is thought. So where we examine the thought process with respect to the form, that is whether presence of formal thought disorder is there or not. To give an example with regard to the flight of ideas, the person would start saying that if I ask a question, did you have your lunch? He would say, yes, I had, but I went to that place, that hotel was not nice, so I went to another hotel where I had only juice and I did not like the food. Then I went to another hotel and had food. So the answer expected was, yes, I had food, but the person would give an unnecessary information where the thought from one to one, like it's been going. With regard to the stream flight of ideas, I would ask a question and the person would start with one idea and then immediately shift to another idea and then go to another idea, then go to another idea. Finally, I may not be able to come to a conclusion. So this is called flight of ideas, where I would start asking him to talk about his job. He would say, I went to job, then I went to that movie and I like that drink. So there is no connection between one thought to the other. The flight of ideas would be there. Some people would have retardation of thinking, like where they would start expressing their thought and then suddenly start stopping, would not explain more about the thought, which would be retardation of thought. Then thought block, suddenly person would experience, I am not able to think, my thoughts have been blocked. Then we look at, do an assessment in terms of the possession, where obsessions and compulsion, any thought alienations been looked at, whether person is having any repetitive thoughts, and those repetitive thoughts have been put into action or not, we are going to look at it. With regard to the content, so we are look at in terms of the presence of overvalued ideas or delusion, single or multiple delusion, the type of delusion can be grandiose, prosecutory, nihilistic, etc. To give an example of a grandiose delusion, person with manic symptom, the person would say like, I know Prime Minister, he is my close friend, I can influence you, influence and get things done for you. So the things which is not possible for him, he will be able to talk, and a lot of grandiose things he would talk, or he would say like, I can talk to God and get things done for you. So those are grandiose ideas. Persecutory delusions like my neighbor has done some black magic against me, or my wife is doing black magic against me, and for that reason I am getting angry with her, and because of that I am not able to do any work. So strongly believe on those delusions. Delusion is something which is unshakable, and a strong belief is there. So need to look in terms of the depressive ideation, whether the person is having ideas of worthlessness, guilt, hopelessness, suicidal ideas. All this information would be covered under the content. Then we look at the mood. So we'll ask the person the subjective report of his mood, and then do an objective evaluation. If you ask how are you, he may say like, I am fine, no problem, I am happy, sad, like that. Based on our observation, we need to give an objective evaluation. So if both are not matching, that means a person would experience that he is happy, and then objective evaluation also indicate that he is very happy, which would indicate that person is having a manic episode. The person says, I am happy but appear depressed, so which is a contradicting information, so which need to be recorded. So we need to have both subjective report and then the objective evaluation also. Need to look at the quality of affect, like happiness, sadness, anxiety, etc. If the person is expressing, we need to look at the content, like why the person is happy, how the quality need to be looked at, and then come to a conclusion whether the person, whatever subjective report been said, can the person elaborate on that and given enough evidences for us to, for him to say that I am happy. Perception. We need to look in terms of the presence of illusion and hallucination. So we all know that we have five senses. So in hallucination, a person with mental illness, particularly a person with schizophrenia, can experience hearing voices like any other voice. In their absence, he will be hearing voices. In their absence, they will be seeing a person. In their absence, they would be smelling things. In their absence, they would be feeling the touch of other person. In their absence, they would feel the taste. They would eat something and then they say like, this food has been poisoned. They can taste the poison smell, poison taste. So hallucinations can be of all these five types which are related to senses. It can be hearing voices, it can be visual hallucination, it can be tasting things, smelling things, it can be. And we also need to look at whether hallucinations are verbal or non-verbal, whether it is continuous or intermittent, is it single voice or multiple voices, is it familiar voice or unfamiliar voices, how far the distance in terms of the voices also. So need to look in terms of whether it's a first person, second person or third person, pleasant, unpleasant hallucination, where first like it will be whether he was getting a commanding instruction from the voices, or is it like people are discussing about this person somewhere near to him, or is it some far place they are discussing and he is able to listen to it, and whether it would be a pleasant for him or it's an unpleasant thing, they need to know. And other perceptual disturbances that must be inquired into include heightened perception, dulled perception, depersonalization, realization, derealization experiences. So next category of assessment is cognitive function, where we look in terms of orientation, time, place and person, whether the person is oriented towards time, place and person. Then assess their attention and concentration, where a digit span test is given, asking him to like say from 1 to 10 and then 1 to 20 and then backward from 20 to 1 again. And memory and immediate memory, recent memory, remote memory being tested, where need to make an assessment whether the person is having memory disturbances. In case if it is a memory disturbances, it would indicate that this person may have dementia. So we need to look at the that part. Then intelligence need to have that the person is having adequate intelligence, whether he can comprehend, do small arithmetic, abstraction, differences, proverbs, whether he can understand proverbs and explain those proverbs. And also need to look in terms of the judgment, give various situations and then find out how the person is going to react in all these situations. And the last part of a mental status examination is insight, whether the person would feel that this I am having some sort of mental illness, or does he feel that this person, I am not having anything, no problem, I am fine. So that need to be looked at. When the person is not having insight or having insight or partial insight, need to be commented by the person who is doing an MSc. So after collecting all this information, we need to make a summary. So we need to give a concise description of all important aspects. Not necessary that we need to give entire information, whichever is relevant for the current understanding, that information need to be culled out and written as a summary, and which would help us to give a diagnosis either on the ICD-10 category or DSM criteria, and also make a provisional diagnosis in case if you are not able to come to any conclusion. So we would give a provisional diagnosis, and the serial MSCs would help us in order to make a proper diagnosis. A provisional diagnosis can be made as a diagnosis later at the later phase. So we also need to come out with the investigation, treatment and follow up, like biochemical, radical or psychometric investigations need to be looked at. In case if a CT scan need to be done or some blood investigations need to be done, all those things need to be determined after discussing with a medical professional, and a thorough medical physical examination need to be done. So which will help us in understanding the physiological factors leading to mental illness. Thank you all. So with this, now we have come to an end of understanding the assessment of a person with mental illness, where the assessment should start from the symptom presentation to symptom description, and then the family history. Then we look in terms of the personal history from the birth to the current stage. If he is married, then married and marital relationship need to be determined. And then we need to look in terms of the premorbid personalities, because it's very important that after treatment the person should be able to go back to the premorbid level of functioning, whatever he or she was performing. And then we need to do a mental status examination, which will provide enough evidences for us to diagnose the person with mental illness either following ICD-10 category or DSM category. And then we have to make a summary and a formulation which will end our assessment. We have also provided information as an e-text. So more details being given in the e-text. So you can always go back and read the e-text, and then you'll be able to understand how to do an assessment. And further reading can be done by looking at the comprehensive textbook of psychiatry, or a short textbook of psychiatry, or any of the psychiatric textbooks you are accessible in your library can be looked at, where a detailed description of assessment has been given, and that will help us in understanding and do an assessment. Everyone cannot be doing an assessment, that this should be kept in mind. Persons who have got training, specific training, only need to attend for an assessment. So with this knowledge would help us in understanding how to do an assessment, but you may not be having sufficient skills in terms of doing an assessment. Why the assessment need to be done and what are the various areas of information need to be collected being covered under this section, but it's not, you will not be having enough skills in terms of doing an assessment. Thank you. Hope you have understood how to do an assessment for person with mental illness following all these various headings what been learned today.